欢迎收看今天的文茜世界财经周报。迈入2017年，我们来看一下到底会发生什么样的事情。2017年有三场大选，这三场大选分别我们在前面文茜世界周报提到了，在3月的荷兰竟然是极右派领先，在5月的法国，在9月的德国，那都是属于欧元国家里头的核心国家。而这几个核心国家都要在2017年的时候进行大选，所以英国的脱欧只是整个欧盟是否分崩离析，欧元将来会不会解体，就在今年可能就出现。而很多人认为，如果可以拖过2017年，整体问题可以被解决的话，欧盟会更强，欧元也会更强。如果没有拖过的话，世界是一个大灾难。另外一个就是川普当选，他有太多不可预测的事情，这将成了2016年所发生的事情里头，2017年1月20号川普正式的就职，将永久的改变世界，也很长的一个时间。
回顾2016年的金融市场，开门首月就是令投资人难忘的一场开门黑。
我老股民了，做了20几年了，对吧？像各种情况是非常的，
跌是可以的，本来就是正负嘛，宽幅正荡可以的，但是这承受不了。
4天4次触发熔断 ，A 股破天荒的提前收市，曾经备受期待的指数熔断机制在一片质疑声当中被紧急撤下，回炉重造。
始于大陆的新年股灾，首次上路的熔断机制是帮凶。由于中国制造业数据延续年底封关的疲软，投资人担心跌幅过大触动熔断，导致停盘，一窝蜂的非理性杀出。加上人行跨年度连续调降人民币中间价，让市场忧心是大陆转型消费经济失败的讯号。两大因素把陆股在新年伊始推向惊涛骇浪，各国金融市场也顺着时差被吞没。仅仅10个交易日后，全球股市就蒸发了4兆美元市值。
China.
一月份压垮全球股市的第二颗巨石是油价。OPEC 为逼退美国页岩油，坚持不减产。伊朗在西方解除制裁后，宣布每日增产50万桶。国际油价就在一片油海中如自由落体般下坠。
Wall Street, U.S. stocks taking a brutal beating right now. Look at those numbers. The Dow down over 540 points. It's been a volatile trading day. All of this, of course, after oil also dropping to new lows.
一月第三周，布兰特原油跌破每桶30美元防线后，触及27块美元，导致投资人对全球经济成长前景忧虑再起。避险情绪急速升温下，市场资金从股市大举撤退，沪股、日股、德股、英股在当周进入熊市，美股则在修正格局中徘徊。新年股在落幕后，投资人怀着笃定心理大举逢低进场，认定英国不会脱欧。孰料半年后黑天鹅降临，英国公投确定脱欧，股灾骤然开启，全球股市2天内蒸发3兆美金，英国自己付出惨痛代价。
The currency hit a fresh low against the US dollar, breaching the $1.28 mark for the first time since 1985.
Brexit has now cost the UK its perfect credit rating from all three of the major agencies. Standard & Poor's calls the UK's vote to leave the EU, what their words, a seminal event, one that will lead to more unpredictability, less stability.From AAA to AA rating.
英国的意外脱欧让投资人惶恐地看着11月8号登场的美国总统大选，因为赌注普遍压在希拉蕊身上。开票过程中，川普的不断领先让全球股市涌现恐慌性买压。
日経平均株価は一時1000円以上値下がり。これは今年6月、イギリスが EU からの離脱を決めた国民投票で、金融市場が大きく動揺した時以来です。
They should be down about 2%. Some futures trading was temporarily halted overnight. That was after the Dow futures, as you mentioned. fell more than 800 points when it became pretty clear that Donald Trump was going to win.
原以为川普当选后掀起贸易大战，股市黑暗期会随之降临，没想到噩梦不但没上演，还成了一出奇幻剧。
Breaking news on the market. A little bit of history. The Dow Jones Industrials has closed above 19,000 for the first time in history. Shortly after the opening bell, the market went straight up like a rocket.
大选隔天，市场接受了共和党赢得参众两院，未来四年完全执政。川普上台后，渴望落实减税、扩大基础建设、放宽金融监管等政策的新政局，一举上演庆祝行情，且持续整整一个月。
Many bankers were dreading the possibility of a Trump presidency before the election, but it's surprising how quickly many of them turned once they began to focus on what the president-elect apparently had in mind for their financial industry.
但川普的当选却增加油市的不确定性。发表百日新政，他誓言上任后大举开挖美国页岩油，于是 OPEC 抢在川普上台前施展了影响油价的最后机会。
I think OPEC needs to make sure that we don't.Crimp too tightly and create a shock to the market. Like I said, we want to be very responsible. The prices have dropped too low. That has impacted investment. Many companies are hurting. Many countries are hurting. That needs to be relieved. But at the same time, we don't want to give the market the opposite signal and shock markets into prices that.That could be harmful.
一直拧打价格战、维护市场份额的产油国盟主沙特阿拉伯，终于承受不住两年来的油市萧条。十一月，借由对伊朗的首度让步，允许德黑兰政府小幅增产，让 OPEC 内部减产协议成功达阵。十二月，又促成俄罗斯等非 OPEC 会员国参与减产，让国际油价显著上扬。布兰特原油一度站至每桶55块美元上方，但岁末年终，人民币确实一路探底。一来是市场担心中国经济持续下滑，资本大举外流；二来是美国升息脚步加快，联准会年底升息一码，还预期明年将升三次。两大空头让人民币迈向22年来最大年贬幅。2016年，金融市场在逃不过的跌宕起伏中，各有输家赢家。
而川普还没有就职美国总统。整个道琼指数呢，从他当选那天，一直到差不多 Christmas 的时候，就已经上涨了将近9个百分点，标普也上涨了6个百分点，不止创下了历史性的字数，就是历史数字是19000点以上，甚至不断的逼近20000点左右，在20000点的上上下下，股市一直认为这会不会太高了？它是不是一场 party？ 是不是像泡沫？美国著名的经济学家，耶鲁大学的经济学家 Robert Shiller， 同时也是诺贝尔经济学家，他就预言他的看法是悲观的。他认为我们现在所看到的华尔街如此好的行情，只是一片盲目的庆祝行情。他不认为川普的经济政策是可行的。
美股派对已开了一个多月，三大指数怀抱着新政府上任后将松绑金融监管、大型基础建设，连番释出政策利多的心理预期。自11月8号川普当选美国总统以来，道琼累计上涨9%，标普6%。道琼更多次挑战20000点历史关卡，可惜总缺临门一脚，静观其却。诺贝尔经济学奖得主、美国耶鲁大学教授席勒近日接受 CNBC 专访时，向投资人提出警告，切莫对这股川普行情过分乐观，因为当前的牛气冲天是种对繁荣增长无法抗拒的心理兴奋，因此无法以市场理论做出合理判断。
Hey, it's psychology of some sort or another. I think Trump is part of it. He just sets an example of, you know, we used to be more into modest living, and now people are thinking doesn't work, you know.You have to live bigly, and then you're on your way. And I think that is plausibly part of it. You know, we don't understand human psychology well enough to explain it with any academic rigor, but it seems like that's a factor.
Cross 5/8 for 49.9.
I'll take 15,000.
席 希勒接着说，千万别以为经济繁盛过后不会得到糟糕的结果。1929年的经济大萧条正是繁荣后的代价。在那之前，一战刚刚结束，欧洲休养生息，美国得利，透过技术革命，经济迅速发展。这段美国历史上所谓的咆哮的20年代。由于总统恰维·柯利兹又称柯利兹的繁荣，但股市投机成风，虚假繁荣过后迎来10年经济萧条。希勒以史为鉴，除了警告投资人当前的股市上涨终究会结束，也不认为道琼一旦突破20000点大关就会一飞冲天，因此建议美股投资人已进场者无需焦急抛售，观望者也不要躁进进场。一来是不知这波川普行情何时会结束，二来是市场出现回档修正的可能性极高。
But right now, I'm, you know, I would still keep a good part of the portfolio in the market. I wouldn't go plunging because it is high and it might go down. The thing is, we just don't know. And even at 28, the tape ratio is not so super high. In the past, it has gone up from this level before. Now, I feel.Funny about urging someone who hasn't been in the market to come in now. First of all, there's the thought that this Dow 20,000 is a resistance level, and we're just going to be stuck at it for a long time. That's another thing that we've seen before in history. You might think that once it passes the level, it would just soar after that, because hey, that was a barrier, and we're through the barrier.
Right.
But history doesn't suggest that. The first time that the Dow passed 1,000.Was in 1972, but it didn't increase above 1100 until over a decade later, 1983. So it's not as if that once you break the barrier, you just go sailing. In fact, it may be that you think that this is it, we'll stay right here.
12月22号的时候，人们正在准备要过 Christmas， 然后以为一切的事情慢慢的在上轨道的时刻，突然普丁宣布他要扩展核武，接着是川普，两个人都在同一天，相隔只有几个小时，都宣布他们要扩展核武。这对人类来讲是一个太难以置信的事情，很大的一项理由很可能跟金正恩或者跟伊朗有关系。跟金正恩有关，大家可以理解，因为金正恩现在越来越不可测。而跟伊朗有关系，这件事情特别要说明一下。不管他所任命的美国驻以色列的大使，以及他在整个中东的政策，都使得《Economist》英国的《经济学人》杂志批评说，川普的意思是准备把华盛顿搬到以色列的首都吗？他想做什么？而川普在竞选的过程中大力抨击的就是奥巴马跟民主党不够支持以色列，他们对伊朗的核协议他很不满意，对这件事情他要特别的处理。所以如果说今天川普他声明他要再度的拓展核子武器，他说因为我们要够强大，有非常大的一个核子武器，我们才能够制服那些可怕的敌人，直到把他们彻底消灭为止，我想他所指的，大多数人判断他所指的，第一个就是朝鲜，第二就是伊朗。但是很悲哀的，俄罗斯也这么做，将来朝鲜也可能这么做，人类就重回了那个 MAD 的疯狂时代。它完全印证了历史哲学家们所说的话，人会不断的复制属于自己的愚蠢。
俄罗斯总统普丁和川普22号达成一项令全世界忧心的共识，就是核武扩张。
President-elect Trump tweeted quote,The United States must greatly strengthen and expand its nuclear capability until such time as the world comes to its senses regarding nukes.
就在这条推特发出的数小时前，俄罗斯总统普丁才讲出了一模一样的话。
We need to strengthen the military potential of strategic nuclear forces, especially with missile complexes that can reliably penetrate any existing and prospective missile defense systems.
华盛顿邮报称，眼下俄罗斯最主要且有能力拦下俄国导弹的敌人非美国和北约莫属，因此普丁提出要强化确保其核武器不会被北约拦截。
Today, we are stronger than any potential aggressor. I repeat, any aggressor.
The two declarations raising the specter of an arms race renewed.
Can a tweet start an arms race? He says we have to expand the nuclear capability. That's the word that everybody's focused in on. That sounds like more...That, and when Russia and the United States, who have 95% of all the nuclear weapons in the world, both start talking at the same time about strengthening, expanded nuclear capability, that's a message to other countries, start your engines.
Today, Russia has 7,300 warheads, the U.S. just over 6,900.
China only has 200 nuclear weapons. What are they thinking? What's India thinking? What's Pakistan thinking? That's the trouble with trying to make foreign policy. These are the kinds of implications you have to consider before you tweet.
事实上，川普22号抛出强化美国核武说绝非突如其来，早在第二场总统辩论中已看得出端倪。
Russia is new.In terms of nuclear, we are old, we're tired, we're exhausted in terms of nuclear. A very bad thing.
But rebuilding is something the Obama administration has already been doing.
Nobody's walked away from the fact that you need a credible deterrent for the United States, including a credible nuclear deterrent. As a matter of fact, we have and continue to review plans for appropriate modernization.
苏联在1949年8月29号成功引爆第一颗原子弹，新一轮的核竞赛随着冷战拉开序幕。古巴危机过后，核竞赛变本加厉。美国认为维持和平的途径不在于拥有比苏联更多的核武，而是确保有能力一次消灭对方 25% 到 50% 的人口。这也就是确保相互摧毁，英文的缩写就是 MAD， 疯狂。为了不走上世界毁灭，1968年由英美、苏联等62国签下核不扩散条约，最后苏联在1991年解体，美苏核武竞赛戛然而止。
Jefferson Clinton。
到了2000年，时任美国总统克林顿和俄罗斯总统普丁签署不管理与处置协议，规范双方各自销毁34吨武器级部，以削减两国核武。但在2016年10月，普丁以美国对俄罗斯不友善为由暂停执行此一协议。不过此时川普强化核武说看似并非针对俄罗斯而来。
The ominous prospect of a nuclear arms race, it's tempered somewhat by a letter of holiday greetings from Russian President Vladimir Putin to U.S. President-elect Donald Trump.
The letter that was sent on December the 15th has only just come out, though, publicly, by Putin to Trump, wishing him the...You know, best regards of the season, and basically saying that he hopes that they can act together in a constructive and pragmatic way to restore the framework of bilateral cooperation.
Quote, a very nice letter from Vladimir Putin. His thoughts are so correct. I hope both sides are able to live up to these thoughts and we do not have to travel an alternate path.
The Trump transition team later issued a statement saying the president-elect was really referring to nuclear proliferation, trying to make sure nuclear weapons are kept out of the hands of terrorists and rogue nations.
川普团队口中的流氓国家显然更多的是指伊朗和北韩。
Has been reported, hasn't been getting the briefings every day, was for North Korea. The Kim regime there, that essentially he might be more aggressive in terms of dealing with North Korea, which is moving towards a nuclear weapon it could potentially place on a missile, and you know, that can reach Japan, obviously, but even arguably the United States. So that's the question, is does an unpredictable Trump, a sense that he could use force, lead smaller countries to sort of think twice about...taking military gambles of their own.
在中东问题上，川普多次对伊朗核协议表达不满。不到一个月后，掌握美国核武权力将转移到川普手中，美国和伊朗的交锋势必更为激烈。
The world is a far safer place now that the Cold War is over. No leader of a small country is worrying and saying to his cabinet.One of these two crazy superpowers is going to get us caught up in a nuclear war.
讽刺的是，冷战结束20年，在美俄带领下，核武扩张再起，毁灭的恐惧仍在持续。
让我们来回顾一下冷战当时最危险的时刻，我刚刚所说的 MAD。 MAD 时代呢，大概时间点呢，最重要的时间点大概在1960年开始。在1960年开始呢，可以说是人类面临核子战争最危险的年代。当时最有名的是 Hawkins， 他因为得了渐冻人症，医生认为他可能只有两年寿命，可是还是有一个美丽的考古学家，他的同学愿意嫁给他。许多人就说，你为什么在那个时刻愿意嫁给一个可能只有两年寿命的人？他帮我们回忆了在1960年代全世界人们所相信的当时的状态。他说，不是电视上天天都说我们随时要跟苏联爆发核子战争，我们所有的人都要毁灭了吗？所以我们可能活不过两年呢，他还可以活差不多两年以上。它并不是一个很严重的事情。你可以想象，在那个时候，核战虽然台湾离得非常远，可是在西方的世界里头，当时冷战的危机非常的严重。而这件事情一直拖到了1969年，由于核战呢几乎拖垮了苏联的经济，于是双方开始了关于核战各方面核子武器的谈判，慢慢谈到了1979年，又停了一段时间，后来到了1990年继续谈，然后最后慢慢开始销毁布，结果我们现在却重新开始了一个新的核子武器竞赛的年代。因为对川普跟对普丁来讲，他们是相信 muscle 的人，他们是相信肌肉的人，他认为你只有足够的勇气才能够摧毁那些邪恶轴心国。
1960年代，冷战中最疯狂的年代，各自拥有核武的美苏改变了战争思维，以 MAD 相互保证毁灭的新策略，把全球安全建立于核武对手之上。
It's not mad. Mutual assured destruction is the foundation of deterrence.
1960年7月1号，美军一架 RB-4G 侦察机自英国基地起飞，执行常规任务，刺探苏联边境的飞弹防御系统，遭到苏联米格机击落。两名美军飞官跳伞逃生，躲不过入监命运，关入莫斯科大牢。美苏开打，气氛正浓，一旦动武，核战似乎难以避免。美制的泰坦飞弹，每颗弹头都能轻易摧毁莫斯科，全已准备发射。
If we had ever received a launch message over the PAS system, I would have had absolutely no doubt that my life expectancy was measured in probably less than a half an hour.
美国不想再被偷袭，毕竟珍珠港事件是锥心之痛。阿拉斯加、格陵兰、英格兰三地导弹预警雷达开始24小时日夜运转。1961年，一触即发的核战氛围当中，甘乃迪就任新任美国总统。小鬼曹随他继任艾森豪任内的大规模报复策略。美国所谓的报复是建立于核武军备的相对优越之上，但苏联正急起直追。
There was a syndrome to catch up and overtake, to try and show everyone that we weren't far behind the Americans, that we too had nuclear weapons.There were those who said that we can only prevent a nuclear war if we oppose world imperialism with a force of similar strength.
苏联领导人赫鲁雪夫采用激进手段，打破暂停核试验的协议，在1961年10月30号引爆了史上最大规模的核弹。一次爆炸量相当于5000万吨 TNT 炸药，超越二战使用的炸弹总量。50公里外的人都被炸断了腿。
In view of the Soviet action, it will be the policy of the United States to proceed in developing nuclear weapons to maintain this superior capability for the defense of the free world against any aggressor.
Then suddenly there is a huge blow as the shockwave hits the plane. All the controls go crazy.
And you have to grab the joystick and quickly, quickly try and get it under control. The plane was thrown from side to side. We knew what a nuclear explosion was like.
但苏联的超级飞弹只是后续一系列核试验的序曲。美国以牙还牙，在内华达州引爆核弹，以为回敬，行径堪称疯狂的美苏，随着欧洲掀起反核浪潮，发生了一场让人类最接近相互毁灭时刻的古巴危机，终于开始检讨核武军备竞赛。美苏头一次有了共识，双方都想避免核战。
It is an ironic but accurate fact that the two strongest powers.Are the two in the most danger of devastation. All we have built, all we have worked for, would be destroyed in the first 24 hours. And even.
但浮出台面的却是一种可怕的逻辑：裁减核武做不到，核战也不可能发生。美国国防部长麦克纳马拉提出全新概念，避免战争的唯一方法。就是相互保证毁灭。
McNamara, in particular, became totally convinced that the only strategy was what is known as mutual assured destruction, MAD for short. And what that meant was that the only way to have stable deterrence in the world was for both sides to be able to kill 25% to 50% of the other's population.
It's not MAD. Mutual assured destruction is the foundation of deterrence.Today, it's a derogative term, but it's those who denigrate it don't understand deterrence. If you want a stable nuclear world, if that isn't an oxymoron, let me rephrase it, to the degree one can achieve a stable,nuclear world, it requires that each side be confident that it can deter the other. And that requires that there be a balance. And the balance is the understanding that if either side initiates the use of nuclear weapons, the other side will respond with sufficient power to inflictunacceptable damage.
美国亲自提出的相互保证毁灭 MAD， 苏联并未买账，继续是保卫本土安全为第一要务，致力研发反弹道飞弹，以拦截战争中的美国飞弹。
First, there used to be a sword, and then a shield. Then a tank.And anti-tank gun.
Неуязвимым средством, что уровень.
Now it turned out that a missile was not invulnerable.
Такого рубежа.
Science and technology was developing so fast. It had become possible to fight the most dangerous.
但对美国来说，苏联借由建构防御系统制造反弹道飞弹，是打破了两国间脆弱的核平衡。
We thought of it as an umbrella. Would an umbrella harm anybody? If it rains, you open it up.
The introduction of ABMs destabilized MAD, the balance of terror.
Balance of terror.
We were both so afraid of nuclear armaments. We knew that you wouldn't strike.And we wouldn't strike. But now, if one side could counter the other's ability to respond, then they had the advantage.
1967年中东战争爆发，美国力挺以色列，苏联背后支持阿拉伯盟军。紧张氛围下，美苏领袖会晤。但双方对削减反弹道飞弹生产未达共识，无疾而终。此时，美国科学家已着手研发分导式多弹头，简称 MIRV， 一枚弹头可搭载十枚导弹。至1969年为止，美苏核武军备花费每天高达5000 万美金，彼此难以承受的军备之重，促成了与赫尔辛基召开的战略武器限制谈判，一拖三年终达协议，反弹道飞弹失宠，双方同意限制开发。对峙气焰高涨的美苏冷战，终于以谈判代替对抗，进入了以缓和对抗冷战的时代。
有些专家如此的诠释川普，他们说川普很可能正在仿效那个年代 Nixon， 也是基辛格帮 Nixon 所草拟的一种外交谈判战略，这个战略就叫做疯子理论。是的，你可能觉得川普是个疯子，但这个疯子并不是真疯子，这个叫做 Madman Theory，我们过去在政治里头比较谈到的叫博弈理论，可是这是一个叫做 Madman Theory， 一个疯子理论，也就是说你让敌方觉得你不可测，你很可能鲁莽行事，而他会遭受到很大的威胁，所以他就会小心谨慎的，第一个容忍你，第二给你更大的空间，第三个就怕激怒的你。那其实在这个状况里头，人们会想到的是金正恩，可是他们认为川普其实正在进行这样一个策略，因为美国的确是有能力摧毁其他的国家，而对方因此收手的几率就会大为提高，所以川普如果在核子武器或者是贸易政策里头看起来像个疯子，他未必是真的疯子，他是一个奉行疯子理论的假疯子。
We must as a nation be more unpredictable.
It's called the Madman Theory, a term and strategy taken from the playbook of former President Richard Nixon. The objective? Keep your enemies guessing about your motives, temperament, and willingness to go to the extreme. Nixon used it to get the North Vietnamese to the table by making them think he'd use nuclear weapons to defeat communism.
Madman Theory, which I watched as a young soldier Nixon and Kissinger do, is to basically use unpredictable, seemingly brash, bravado, over-escalation to get the other side to fall off its positions.
Trump has used similar questions about how he would handle foreign confrontations, refusing to rule out nuclear weapons,
and I can't take anything off the table,
calling for a ban on Muslims,
a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on.
And most recently taking a call from the president of Taiwan, a break with diplomatic tradition billed as a calculated ploy for leverage.
I don't know why we have to be bound by a one China policy unless we make a deal with China, having to do with other things, including trade.
But some warn about taking the madman approach too far, saying Nixon knew not to corner his adversary.
You have to give them a way out. If you have a zero-sum game end along with a highly risky roll the dice, look at me means, you are going to sooner or later run into very, very serious trouble.
And some call it a dangerous gambit in a world craving stability, where unpredictable leaders like North Korea's Kim Jong-un could call his bluff.
There is no question that there is a time and a place for performance art, even in diplomacy. There are times when you kind of make your adversary just not sure at all what you're going to do. But I don't think you can play that all the time, and I know you can't play it as a substitute for really knowing what the issues are.
1991年苏联正式的解体，而戈巴舍夫正式的下台。最近他接受了专访，接受英国 BBC 的专访，谈到当时自己下台的过程，下台的原因。英国 BBC 也给予他一个比较公平的一个评价，认为帝国的瓦解的责任并不是他，而事实上是在冷战过程当中最终的军备竞赛，以及让苏联的经济彻底崩溃，接近通货膨胀。 所以他根本没有能力维持这么大的一个苏联帝国，他也没有能力再维持如此的一个盟邦。他进行的政治改革是一个不得已的政治改革，而这个不得已的政治改革并不符合鹰派在当时对这个事情的看法，他们发动了政变，而因此最终戈巴什夫下台了。戈巴什夫最近接受 BBC 访问的时候，看起来比过去老了非常多。他谈到当时下台的原因，对于普丁呢，他语带保留，相当有一定程度的讽刺。可是他认为西方对俄罗斯不够了解，某个程度来讲，他也看到了在后来苏联崩解以后，整个俄罗斯所出现的腐败状况，他觉得这是匪夷所思。但是他也特别提到了几个情形，他认为全世界其实对俄罗斯并不够了解，他们有很多图腾，包括美国都有非常多的图腾今天在脑袋里头。那川普呢，上台之后他准备全面的改善美国和俄罗斯之间的关系，戈巴什夫也做出了他的评价。
俄国总统普丁被《富比士》杂志选为今年的年度世界强人，这是他连续第四年获选。从占领乌克兰，支持叙利亚内战，他挥舞着后现代俄罗斯帝国主义大旗，在国际舞台上为所欲为。和普丁几乎不可能的对话，让西方国家的领导人无法不怀念上个世纪致力与西方沟通、向往东西和平共存的另一位莫斯科强人——戈巴契夫。30年前，他是1987年《时代》杂志的年度人物，是影响80年代的十年风云人物，1990年的诺贝尔和平奖得主。1991年的12月21日，他直接在电视上宣布苏联共和的瓦解，4天之后辞去了总统的职位。在苏联解体25年纪念的前夕，他非常难得的接受专访。江山有恨，英雄老矣，再回首已百年生。今年85岁的戈巴契夫不后悔当年选择离开，大丈夫有所为有所不为。
не хотел бы ни в одном ни в другом случае, чтобы мы не схлопотали гражданскую войну. А все было на мази, мази. Представляете, если бы раскол и борьба за власть в стране такой, как наша, перенасыщенной оружием, включая и ядерное, это значит, что Горбачеву для того, чтобы удержаться у власти, пошел на вот это все. Людей бы сколько уробили, разрушение все. Нет, это я не могу допустить.И моя победа состоит в том, что я покинул власть.
再看当今叙利亚，枪口对着自己人民的阿萨德，以古见今，不胜唏嘘。他和哈利波特一样，额头上有着著名的红酒胎记，虽然不能像哈利波特一样随心所欲的穿墙，是他让柏林围墙在1989年倒下。让分裂了45年的东西德完成统一，最后和美国签署了终止冷战的协议，彻底改写了世界历史和欧亚的地理版图，终结了美苏核武角力对全人类的毁灭性威胁。一个强人的陨落，一个时代的结束。25年之后，充满野心的普丁，庭院深深，从克林姆林宫操纵着世界大局，重新做起了帝国主义的大梦。戈巴契夫指责西方透过媒体打击俄国，蓄意地把普丁妖魔化。
специальная установка для всей прессы. Вам тоже должна быть установка. Это же точно. Я знаю. На Запада добиться того, чтобы скомпрометировать Путина и устранить его. 86% Путина поддерживают.
普丁有没有请教过他呢？戈巴契夫欲言又止。
Он все знает. Но каждый хочет все по-своему. Лилави.
那他是怎么看川普的呢？
Человек, имеющий мало опыта политического. Но может быть это и хорошо. Не будем договариваться, не будем
объединяться, вести разговор, все. Будут вооружаться все. А потом, значит, вот хотим мы или нет, срывается. Ружье вот висит, висит. Если, говорит, в начале спектакля, это Чехов, по-моему, сказал, лежит ружье, то оно обязательно в конце выстрелит.
柏林围墙倒下之后，向往世界和平，免除核污毁灭威胁的人类，在共产主义粉碎之后，资本主义的自由经济没有上限的走向狂野的全球化市场。壁垒分明的冷战对峙，转换成了宗教狂热和民族主义的拉扯，核子武器的全面武装，退让给烽火四起的内战和恐攻。 倒下的柏林围墙被另外一座看不见的围墙取代，他从来没有放弃过的对话和沟通，成了遥不可及的神话。戈巴契夫见证了一个充满可能的时代，一个选择放弃权力却没有放弃梦想的真正的英雄。
2017年，我们要送给大家一个礼物，就是什么样子的人生叫做幸福的答案？访问了巴菲特，访问了达赖喇嘛，也访问了欧布莱，这个是彭博所制作的一系列的大思想家中一个非常值得推荐的很好的一个专题，而他们的共同答案却如此的简单，四个字：知足常乐。送给各位 ，Happy New Year。
We have just body and mind, emotion. I want to ask them, billionaire, if you see because of the money, no longer any emotional problems, then I think I have to accept money really brings real happiness. But some of my friend, I think very rich, but mentally very unhappy. So that clearly shows the billions of money fail to bring inner peace.
I do feel good about the people that work around me, people I've worked with over the years. I feel good about my children, grandchildren. So it is not a function of money with those people.
So you would say you're a success?
Well, I would say that I'm working towards it.
Are you successful?
I don't know, frankly. Depends on the day. I think that I've been, obviously have been successful in some things. I haven't succeeded in everything that I have wanted to do. I have been successful in my children. I have three fantastic daughters who make me feel that I have succeeded in a very important way.
I would say if I have to look inside me, what is for me, yeah? Well, is to be capable to sleep well. Not have in my conscience, you know, some facts which disturb me. I say, okay, maybe Napoleon was a success, but Napoleon was also capable to destroy so many things. So to me, I have to compatibilize what is the external success with your own sense that, well, I did what was possible to do.
Yeah, Mark Twain always said, you know, always tell the truth and you'll never have to remember what you said. And that's, there's a lot of, you know, if you always behave in an ethical way, you're going to sleep well at night. You're going to know that there's nothing to be exposed, there's nothing to hide, there's nothing to haunt you. You're not hiding some deep, dark secret. And so, absolutely.
So you would say happiness is directly related to being principled?
I think it's a necessary but not sufficient thing for happiness.
人类的物质生活水平比过去任何一个时代都充足富裕，但是精神品质却变得更加贫乏，甚至偶尔陷入价值混乱。彭博新闻尝试从所谓的成功人士身上寻找拥有幸福的答案。 他们在访谈中再次证实了老生常谈的理论，那就是金钱绝非万能，而幸福其实一点都不难，不外乎过得坦荡，知足常乐，活在当下。
One perspective on that question is to ask yourself,
Looking back towards the end of my life, how will I evaluate myself? How will I think about the value of my own life? How will I, will I think it has been a meaningful life, which I've achieved things worth achieving, helped people worth helping, being helped by people who loved me and who cared about me? So there's no guarantee that a person who's doing the right thing will necessarily have a large amount of pleasure in their life, but that what they will have is the deep satisfaction that comes to a moral person from knowing that they have done or tried to do what was right.
Billionaires' size of stomach, same. And the fingers, only 10 fingers. So some diamond ring, I think only one or two, nice. 10 rings, looks not nice. And the stomach, same size. A billionaire stomach, see, bigger one, then of course they have some justification, more money. But the same size of stomach, only two eyes.
Every generation, every people should have a decent life. And that's already what the Gandhi said, that there is enough in this world for everybody's need, but not on everybody's greed. And I think that this is also something. And it doesn't mean that you would have the less quality in your life. It means that you have perhaps some things less quantity, but you will have enough quality.
How did you feel the day you gave 99% of your wealth to philanthropy?
Well, the timing of what I did with, in terms of making a pledge to philanthropy, was affected by when Susie died. When she died first, I had to make a decision as to the best way to use that, these claim checks, that money that had no utility to me and that had enormous utility to others. And I wanted to come up with a rational decision on that as to the most useful way to get that money to society. And she saw every person as individually important. She felt that if there were 6 billion people on this planet, that everyone deserved the same chance in life, the same chance for health, same chance for education, and all of that. Most interesting quality in life almost is love, because you can't get rid of it. I mean, the more you give away, the more you get back. And if you try and hold on to it, you don't have any.
当你付出的爱越多，你得到的越多。你想抓得越紧，你会一无所有。这是巴菲特最后的结论。谢谢收看今天文茜的世界财经周报，我们下礼拜见。Happy New Year。